speaker for this semester. I wanted to introduce Pablo Velber as a staff engineer at Google. He's worked at Google since 2004. He's one of the creators of Google Now. Before joining Google, he worked for a few startup companies in the Bay Area and in Buenos Aires, Argentina. He'll be us in information systems from Buenos Aires, Universidad de Belgrano, Buenos Aires, has a master's in software engineering from Carnegie Mellon University. And his daughter and my daughter actually were in the same class also last year in Adelante. So my pleasure to introduce Pablo for our speaker.
Are you guys hearing me okay? All right. Before we get going, I want to get a sense of how many of you are thinking about doing something related to computer science. Can you give me a show of hands? All right. I hope by the end of the talk I convince everybody to do something in computer science. So let me tell you a little bit of what I'm going to talk about today. I'm going to talk a little bit about how I got to Silicon Valley and how I got into computers. And then I'll go a little bit into the program I did at Carnegie Mellon, software engineering. And if I have time, I'll talk a little bit about my current work at Google, and particularly Google Now. So, as you can imagine from my accent, I grew up in a different country. I grew up in Argentina. And please don't confuse it with Brazil, especially if we are talking about soccer, okay? No confusion, please. And I started playing with computers when I was in high school. The first computer I played with was this Commodore PET, the personal executor transactor. It was a business computer that a friend of mine happened to have at home, and my mom, of course, she wanted me to always for me to do something useful with that. So she got a guy to teach us a little bit, and we started playing with basic things. But unfortunately, there were not good compilers or parsers for it, so we literally were doing some assembly programming and machine code, and I was kind of very low level, and I didn't get to enjoy that much. The other problem is I didn't have a computer at home, so I literally would go home and couldn't practice anything. So, although I didn't get a good feel about it, it was like a seed that was planted in my head about doing something with computers. A couple of others that were very popular back then were the Texas Instrument 94 and the Commodore 64, because it had 64 bytes of memory in RAM. Fantastic. Best thing ever. So, of course, by the time I was done with high school, I didn't know what to do. And you can see a little program on what happened. So, given that I was done with high school and no idea what to do, I decided to go sailing. And literally, because I like sailing, and I was talking to some friend of mine in high school about going to the merchant marine, I said, oh, that might be a fun thing to do. So when I went to apply for the merchant marine, I realized that the admission test was a very difficult test. And up to that point, I mean, in this education system that is very different from the US, it's not competitive at all, because most of the schools, the good schools in Argentina run by the states, are completely free. And although there is an admission test, once you pass the test, that's it. There is nobody looking at your grades during high school or anything else or recommendation letter. It was literally, you need to pass the test and you'll be in the university. And suddenly I go here and they say, yes, you can do this, but we have roughly 15 spots for 300 people. So you have to take this very difficult test. That is a full week of tests. It was on Monday we do algebra and arithmetic, on Tuesday we do trigonometry, on Wednesday we do geometry, and go on. And you literally be cutting down the number of people every day. So I decided to start preparing for the test. But what happened was that at that point, there were already people who were taking this and preparing for the test for a year or a couple of years. And you literally had to have a near perfect score, or a perfect score to do that. So of course, during those conditions, it took me a couple of years to get in. And I finally applied, got in, and we started taking some trips, and eventually in the second year, we did a trip in one of these container ships to the North Atlantic. And coming down from the North Atlantic, I realized that I really didn't want to do this forever. So I started thinking about what was that I had done in high school that really I like to do, and I went back to this idea of old computers and the fact of programming the computers and whatever. So then I came back and I decided to look for computer science schools. And I signed up for a small private university of the Universidad de Belgrano. I took all the standard classes there, you know, computer networks, operating systems. But what was interesting is that the sector that was using these skills in Argentina was only the IT sector, because Argentina is a country that is mainly a consumer of technology, it's not a producer of technology. So I will be looking at these interesting concepts of very low level things of operating systems or algorithms and data structures at school. But then what the market was asking for was databases and other kinds of things that were very interesting to me, and I actually worked for three years in the industry there. But I wanted to do something a little bit different. To the point that I couldn't even say what it was, because I didn't know that the technology sector existed. And at that point, everything I could do with computer was just IT. And the big difference between that and the technology sector is, in IT, you're normally supporting the business of the corporations. So if you're working for a pharmaceutical company, you're working to kind of support their business, but you're not working to develop something that is the end point of the corporation. So anyways, I started playing with this and going through school, and eventually, when I was finishing up, I had a conversation with a professor, and he started mentioning something about Carnegie Mellon and a new program in software engineering there. And at the same time, I grabbed from a friend of mine a book called From Pepsi to Apple. I don't know if you ever read this book. This book is about the story of John Sculley. He's the guy that took over the job of CEO in Apple. Steve Jobs brought him into Apple, and then he ended up kicking Steve Jobs out of Apple. And although the story, you know how it ends, what was interesting is in the book, I got my first taste of what the Silicon Valley was about and what the technology business was about. And at this point, if you compare against yourself, I have been already taking this detour for 4 years, okay, before starting computer science school. That means that if you look at yourself, you can still take 1 year off to goof around, come back, and you still are ahead of me. Okay? And then I had to take 5 more years to go there. So at that point I decided I'm going to go straight to graduate school. Now what's interesting in Argentina, in computer science or in general in the university, the concept of internships doesn't exist. So literally, the way you get expertise on a particular job is by starting working doing that job in the last 2 years of your career. So most people either get a part-time job, maybe they work in the mornings or the afternoons, or in my case, they get a full-time job and then they go to school at night. And that's what I was literally doing. So I was already working in the industry, just getting some experience programming, doing some programming in the IT industry. And then I started thinking, okay, I'm applying to graduate schools. And so, of course, I ended up applying to Carnegie Mellon, I got accepted, and off I went. It was a very big shock coming from a different country, especially for a lot of reasons. The first one, the language barrier. If you're having difficulty understanding me right now, imagine 12 years ago or 15 years ago, I couldn't literally say a word in English. Every time I had to do a write-up, it would literally tell me 6-7 more times that for a native speaker. And there were a lot of interesting things that were caught my attention. One of them was that the first day we were sitting there and people are already interviewing for jobs. And I'm like, what are you talking about? Yeah, you're doing all these interviews or whatever. And I'm coming from this country that is always short term. We think I'm a couple of weeks ahead and that's it. And these people are interviewing for a position for a year and a half in advance. And I'm like, I couldn't even put that in my head. And of course, I had to rush through the program because that year in particular, they decided to compress the program. The program was a year and a half program. And a lot of the people going through the program were sponsored by the companies. And the companies were complaining, you know what, it's too expensive to have our employees not present in the companies for a year and a half, and in addition had to pay for the program. So they were asking, can you compress the program? And I said, sure, we compress the program. And they literally had 6 months, but they didn't remove any classes out of it. So they literally had more classes in less amount of time. So we had this 60 to 70 hours a week during school for a full year to be able to finish the program in 1 year. And so it was a very tough program. And by the time I was done with it, again, I had no idea what to do. And at this point, I had no interviews again. I had an interview, I didn't even know what the whole idea was. And I don't know, maybe a month before we're done, a recruiter happened to call me and said, hey, I have a position for some software engineers at Xerox. And I said, sure, let's go to the interview. And because I didn't have anything else to do, they accepted the position, and so I decided to go there. So I ended up landing in Rochester, New York. Oops. And in upstate New York, in the Wilson Research Center. I don't know if anybody knows anything about Rochester, but there are three things there. Kodak, Xerox, and tons of snow. There is a problem if you like alpine skiing, because there are no mountains. So you get all the snow, but no mountains. So I landed there, and I was in this group that was the Xerox Architecture Center. And the interesting thing was that Xerox had all these groups that were working on these different product lines. They would be working in the small printers or the large products or whatever. And our group was supposed to be a horizontal group that would go and tell these guys what's the software architecture they should use to develop their products. And of course, you can imagine when you go to talk to a product manager whose only problem is, I need to get this out of the door, I'm writing this software that is completely monolithic, is highly optimized. What the heck are you talking about, this architecture, this fantastic, flexible, whatever, that is completely useless to me? So it was a very difficult thing to even sell the whole idea. And a few months later, I started to get bored, and I feel that, well, I probably should be doing something else. And I had a friend that was with me during the program that had stayed for an extra quarter at Carnegie Mellon, and ended up coming to the Valley to work for a company called Inktomi. I don't know if anybody remembers Inktomi. Anybody? Oh, you are so young. Inktomi was, at some point, the search engine for Yahoo. It's a company that is long gone, as it happens in the Valley. And so this guy was calling me, the internet revolution is happening, and he's literally calling me and saying, you need to come here, this is fantastic, there are tons of opportunities and whatever. I'm there in Rochester, New York, shoveling snow. I'm thinking, what the heck am I doing here? So eventually I get a company to give me a job offer, and I decided to land in the Valley. But of course, this was my view of the Valley. I'm thinking, oh, this is fantastic, look at this. And by the time I land here, this is how it looked. It's a war zone. It's a war zone. I landed in the Valley in June of 2000. The Nasdaq had peaked in March of 2000, and then it started going down. The technology sector was falling apart like crazy. Companies were closing right and left. They were laying off people. And the company that hired me laid us all off 3 months later. So we literally land. Some people that I never met just say, hey, hi, how are you? Blah, blah, blah. You see me in the desk. And then 3 months later, they say, by the way, we are laying everybody off. Bye bye. So I literally had to find another company to survive. I ended up in this company called Blue Martini Software that was doing some e-commerce suite. And I survived there for 4 years. And the company was public by the time I got there, because I don't know if you guys remember, but back then the main idea is the companies would go and be public and have a big IPO, and everybody was making tons of money, but that never materialized. All these companies were under like crazy. So I landed in this company, and then every quarter after we announced the results, then we lay off people. And I literally had to survive 11 months of layoffs during 4 years. And the main reason I want to stay there is because I'm having this green card process. See, I'm trying to get my green card so I can remove myself from company to company. So what happens if you lose your job there? The green card goes bye-bye and you have to start all over again. So literally there I would do whatever. Anything that they asked me to do, I would do it so that I can stay in the company to get the green card. And finally, by the time I got my green card, I was ready to move. And then that's the point I said, okay, now that I have my green card, I kind of buy a little bit of my freedom, and that's when I ended up going to Google. So, let me go back a little bit at this point to the program at Carnegie Mellon. And one of the things that was interesting the first few days of Carnegie Mellon is the professor came and put a slide like this, and by the way, this is not Pittsburgh, okay? This is the Pont du Gard. It's an aqueduct built by the Romans in the first century. And I don't remember if it was this picture or some similar picture, but the point that he was trying to make is that as an engineering discipline, computer science and software engineering is a very young discipline. And he was comparing this to civil engineering. You have a lot of examples of civil engineering, even the pyramids of Egypt, that are like 5,000 years old. And you compare that to computer science, that is roughly, what, 60, 70 years, depending on who you consider the father of computer science. And we are like trying to even find our way around, trying to understand what we're building, how we measure, how we test. And so the point of the program, in particular this program I'm taking at Carnegie Mellon, was to try to formalize a little bit this and figure out what are the kinds of areas we need to invest more, we need to investigate, to do more research about, to start making computer science an engineering discipline. Something that can be repeatable, that is, there is standards, that everybody knows when you hire a person as a software engineer, what exactly you're buying into. And that's still a very difficult thing to do. And that's the reason why you buy a software product, there's no warranty. Have you ever returned software because it has a bug?
Yeah.
Really? All right, so you'll be the first one if you do that. So bugs are part of the life cycle of the software product. And I'm sure that if you get a car and suddenly it just stops, and they tell you you have to restart or reboot the battery, new battery, whatever, as soon as you bought it, you're going to be very pleased. Well, that's exactly what happens with software. You keep doing patches every now and then, security patches, updates, whatever. So anyways, the program was organized around a set of core classes, and the core classes everybody had to take. And these were the kind of things that they still believe that they are very important to kind of research more and investigate more and have a common understanding. And in addition to this, there was also a project that you had to work. You literally get an external client. Well, in some cases it was an external client, but you get a real-life client from the university or from external. In my case, I worked for a project for Schwab, the stock trader in San Francisco. And by applying some of the principles you were learning in the classes, you have to put together a project for them and deliver the project at the end of the program. So it was a very nice combination between the theory and some of this math and logic and the actual practice of having to put this and apply them in real life to a real life problem. So in particular, for models, the main idea behind models was trying to learn about modeling techniques and notation techniques that could help you think about some of the aspects of the problems, in particular about maybe concurrency aspects of the problem. That's something very common nowadays. As you probably are aware, nowadays it's very common that computers have all multicores. And that means that in order for you to make use of these multicores, you have to have concurrent programming. Basically, the way the program executes is in parallel, not in sequential order. And that means that now compilers do optimizations where you have out-of-order execution. Literally, when you look at the program, you're going to look at the program, the way you read it is not the way it's going to get executed in the computer. The compiler is going to optimize this. And in order for you to understand what's happening, you have to have some notion of a modeling or how it's going to deal with memory accesses and stuff like that. And some of this work ended up in things like the Java memory model and a couple of other things that are trickling down to all the programming languages. So the idea behind models is like, okay, can you have all these formal notation systems that allow you to formalize these requirements and formalize the system so you can think about these issues in an unambiguous way? Can you do some proofs of stuff like that? So we look at state machines, formal notation with something called the Z language, formal logic, invariants, stuff like that. On the analysis side, we're doing a lot of static program analysis, model checking, and theorem proving, and this is the idea that once you have all those models, then what can you do with them? And the best example in the static program analysis, if you look at the implementation of generics, if you have done any C or Java programming language, generics is an implementation where you have strong types that are propagated through language for collection of objects. And so this is one of the things you want to do, because what you want to do is you want to try to ensure that your program is correct before it runs, and if you have static compiler checks, it's way better than having blowing up at runtime. That was one of the biggest issues before Java implemented generics in version 1.5. So again, one of the things that it was very difficult, that is still very difficult, is to prove that a program is correct, And this is an interesting bar that a friend of mine found. Let me see if I can bring it up. See, in 2006, I was sharing the office with Josh Block. He's one of the guys that wrote Effective Java and half of the Java libraries. Well, it doesn't seem to go down. And he happened to realize that the binary searches we've been using for the last 30 years is broken. It has a bug. We've been teaching binary search for the last 30 years, and it has a bug. And the bug is that this line in number 6 is causing an overflow. And of course, it hasn't been found because, as you said, you have to have a very large number, and at the time that this algorithm was put in place, there was something that nobody was doing. So these kinds of things are still happening, and happening in low-level code. This is literally every binary search. If you've done any programming, you understand the implications of this. It goes to the core of the thing, and this was found in 2006. So it's a few years ago. So the point is that it's still very difficult to prove that programs are correct. And that's why there are a lot of like theories and research that's happened in that area. We also look at a few different models, like traditional waterfall models, object-oriented, iterative. This was different design techniques, how you develop a system, and stuff like that. And finally, the architectures. The other thing we studied was as similar to what we do in civil engineering. Can we find some software architectures that have some nice properties, and then by studying those properties, figure out when we need to build a new component, whether it fits in any of those, or whether we can borrow from one or the other one. And so it was a very interesting class to kind of learn a little bit about these things and then see how they can map to the real life systems. And also, we have, like I said before, a real life project. And what was interesting about the real life project is that it gave an opportunity for a couple of things. First, to kind of give a feel for what was the real technology landscape that we were going to face after we were done with school. And this landscape is very interesting because it's very fast paced. There's constant change. And the competition is one click away. On the web, when I go to Google or Yahoo, it's like, I need to just type a few more characters, I'm in a different place. It's kind of like everybody's in paranoia mode. There are new ideas constantly coming up. It's very clear, if you've seen suddenly about the acquisition, brought to Facebook and WhatsApp, there is no monopoly on what a social network is. We all thought that there was, but clearly there is not. So all these new ideas suddenly rise at some point. And so it's a very, very interesting environment. And so having a strong skill set is key, because then it'll help you to adjust change very fast. The other interesting thing about having the real-life project is that it exposes us to a few of the roles that you're going to find in the software sector. And these are just a few of the ones, the most common ones. But by going through this real-life project, the idea was that when you start the program, you can decide, oh, for this semester, I want to be doing some development. And some other guy would say, I want to do a little of the tech lead or the product management. And so you can play with the different roles. In particular, some of these are the most common ones. So the software engineers normally are the developers, the ones that write the software. Software engineers in test are your best partners. They are literally going to be there to help you ensure that the software you're writing is doing what it's supposed to be doing. Site reliability engineers are the guys that are working normally in operations. They are the guys that are keeping up the website app and ensuring that if there is some security issue or some attack or whatever, they are always going to have a mechanism to keep things going. Product managers are normally people that, in general, at least at Google, they are people that has a computer science, they have a computer science degree, and then they end up doing a master in business. So they are a little bit more about the product and less about the details on how to build that product. UX engineers are the ones that work on the user interfaces, and normally you have a mix of researchers and people that do a lot of UI. Then you have researchers in any particular area, and normally the researchers are looking after particular problems that are very difficult, although they don't have any solution, clear solution yet. And finally, you have webmasters that are the ones that are responsible for a particular website, especially in internet companies. So these are a few of the roles that you're going to find in the software sector, and the roles that we could play in those real-life projects, and so it was very, very useful for us. So Let me take now a step back and start the last part of the talk with a quote from Alan Kay. Alan Kay is one of the pioneers in the object-oriented languages. He's one of the creators of Smalltalk. And in 1971, he said this interesting phrase that the best way to predict the future is to invent it. And a few years ago, I was finishing up a project at Google, and I was looking for something new to do. And so I started talking to a few people, and I came across a guy, and we started working on something, some new ideas. And although we didn't want to think about, oh, we're inventing the future, whatever, but one of the things we wanted to do was try to make smartphones really smart. Because smartphones right now are very powerful, and they give you access to a lot of information, but you still have to do a lot of the heavy lifting yourself. See, you have to switch between apps, you have to type in these little devices, it's very difficult to do. If I ask you, try to type 10 URLs in 1 minute in these devices, you laugh at me. So we were trying to simplify that. And so we ended up creating something that's called Google Now. And just to get a feel for it, how many of you have heard of Google Now? Okay, so good. So I'm gonna have a little bit, a quick introduction and video. This is the promotional video. Let's see if this works. Of course, I need volume. Hold on a minute. All right. Let's do this again. Hold on a minute.
Instead of having to sift through and organize all the information you need throughout your day, all that information is ready at the exact moment you actually need it. Introducing Google Now. Now with Android, one simple swipe gives you the information that is relevant to you, right now. As you leave your house, Google Now is smart enough to check current traffic conditions and has prepared an alternate route for your commute. Google Now is always one step ahead, so you can feel more confident as you navigate your day. When you're at a subway station, Google Now can tell you what trains are next, find you interesting local places to eat. Is there a good Japanese noodle bar nearby? And when you're in a restaurant, your phone already has the best dishes listed for you. Google Now automatically keeps you updated on your favorite sports teams in real time, just in case you're curious about that no-hitter. With the predictive power of Now, you get just what you need to know right when you need it.
So Google Now is one of these pros that is what's called predictive search. And the idea is that by doing analysis on data about a particular user, we can start learning patterns and patterns of what the user do. And by doing that, we can start predicting what the user is going to do and what information he or she is going to need. And when we started this work, we ended up publishing this paper. The small paper was accepted in ACM as a poster paper. And one of the things I was looking at was how we can use location information. These phones are very powerful in the sense that they have tons of sensors that computers never have. And one of the sensors they have is GPS or Wi-Fi or whatever. So they are a perfect mechanism to collect data. And so what happened was that we started looking at what can we do when you start collecting data, in particular location history. And the first thing we were doing was clustering home and work, trying to figure out where the user lives and where the user works. And if you look at the papers back then, the state of the art, when we started this, of course, there were tons of papers in the space. But most of them were interesting. They were assuming that you can have a backpack full of batteries and I can run the phone with GPS on all the time, and I can get this nice set of data at the 1 minute of accuracy, and the data was perfect. And the reality is completely different. First of all, you never use GPS on these phones because it drains the battery in a couple of hours. GPS doesn't work in buildings, so you don't use it, you wouldn't get anything in these places. And the data is very, very sparse, so it's a completely different reality when you look at the actual data we were collecting. So we started looking at this and we came up with an idea on how to do clustering of home and work. And then I started looking at, well, given that we know where you live and we know when you work, where you work, Can we do commit analysis on that? And we found an interesting algorithm to do commit analysis by using an existing system that we had at Google. And the idea was that, imagine that you have two points, the beginning of your commute and the end of your commute. And this is the generic route that the system will give you. And today, if you use Google Maps, that's exactly what you get. The system is called Pathfinder. I put a destination and an origin point, and I get a commute, the generic route. Now, what happens is that most people don't take that route. That's the generic route that we compute based on a few algorithms. So what we wanted to use is this system iteratively, in a recursive way, to try to fit the points to the real commute. So we started by just throwing those, and then start comparing the points in the commute that we get with the points that the person actually takes. Those are the blue dots there. And when we find a point, when we find a point that is a little bit far, like this one, so what we'll do is that we'll add it to the set of points that we sent to the Pathfinder, and we'll start the process all over again. So what we produce at that point is that we start fitting the path to the points that the user actually takes, until eventually these things converge, and we get the actual point. With a few waypoints, we can get the actual route that the user takes. And that also gives us an idea of what we call the commute window, basically the time that we normally go from home to work and work to home. And so once we started doing this, we realized, well, now that we know this information, instead of you having to check the traffic conditions, we can pop up a car and show you the real traffic conditions at the right time when you need. And this was the main idea that we have right now, the main algorithm that still runs in the existing traffic card. So we literally show you this card at the time that you're gonna commute. If you're commuting in the morning, for instance, in my case, I'm going from River City to Mountain View in the mornings from 8 to 10, though I see this car only at that time. It shows constantly the real-time conditions. The car disappears later on because I don't need it anymore, I don't commute in the middle of the day. And then by the time it's 5 p.m., the car is going to pop up again, and it's going to tell you what the real traffic conditions are. And we started with this, and from there we grow the problem with a lot of similar ideas. What can we predict about the user behavior? For instance, given that I know where I work and where I live, I can start showing weather for those locations. And then we integrate that with other sources of data. For instance, if you have a flight ticket in your email, and we know you're going to do some to New York or whatever, the day before that, you're going to see a card that says, your ticket is here, your flight is on time, or your flight got delayed. And by the way, the weather in New York is this. So you start getting a compelling experience by just knowing what the user is going to be, without having to type anything. You don't have to type anything, just we infer these things. And so, we believe that this is gonna be a trend going forward, in particular because if you think about it, there is a big trend on wearables. I'm sure you guys have heard of this. And wearables are all these other devices, like Google Glass, the Fitbit things, or the watch that we announced on SDK a week ago, where the form factors are very important. These things have a ton of sensors, but the form factors are very different. Can you imagine typing a URL on this device? There's no even keyboard there. Of course, they're gonna have voice activated and stuff like that, but you're also gonna need these kind of predictive interfaces. You're gonna need these capabilities to kind of show that information when the user needs it, so the user can quickly dismiss what he doesn't care about and find the right things. And so, really, there's gonna be a lot of opportunity, and it's just the very beginning of this predictive search space. And it's a pretty good opportunity for us to be investing in right now. So let me close the talk with the one thing I hope you remember from this talk. If you go home tonight and somebody asks you, hey, how was the talk? This is the only thing I want you guys to remember. The graph I'm showing you here, let me explain it to you. I took this from the Wolfram Armfra website, and they had this timeline of the events during the history of humanity, where there were events about data collection. For instance, when the first census happened, or when the print was invented in the Renaissance. And then they laid out this time history, the timeline of events. And this view is a cumulative version of that graph. And the nice thing about this, in this cumulative view, you can see how things shift in time. And you can see there how things shift in time from ancient Babylon to Greece to continental Europe. And one of the key things that happen is that in Europe, I just call out three things. Roughly in the 1500s to the 1700s, the Renaissance was happening, and the epicenter of that was in continental Europe, in particular in Italy and Florence. Further down the road, you have the Industrial Revolution happening in Great Britain and in London as the epicenter. And if you keep going up, everything is shifting to the US. Where do you think the revolution is happening right now? Anybody? In the valley. Exactly where we are all standing. So you guys have a tremendous opportunity because you are where things are happening right now. It's not just, it's a unique opportunity because you're here. You don't need to go through those hoops I have to go or jump or whatever to get here where things are happening. And what's interesting is that high density creates a ton of opportunity. When people come to Google to dinner or to have lunch, they see that we are all crammed in these little rooms and they're thinking, these guys cannot afford better offices. That's the whole point. You want high density because when there's high density, that's when you have a communication with somebody else. That's when you talk to another person and an idea happens. So you are right here. It's a unique opportunity for you guys to go and make these things happen. So the point is invest in yourself. If you're still thinking about doing it, this is the best place to do it. And this is the time to do it. Remember, as I said before, if you still go off and go for a year, you're still ahead of me. I haven't even started my career in computer science at this age. Okay? So please remember this slide. So finally, there are a few interesting books or papers if you want to take a look about. There is a nice book that explains a little bit the history of computation. It's called Engines of Logic by Mike Hervis. This is a very interesting paper. I know some other speakers talk about it, but this is the key paper that Turing wrote on computable numbers. He's considered the father of the computer, of the software. Then you have a book from John Bentley, Programming Pulse. It's an interesting book about basics of programming. And on the more on the inspirational side, the last lecture from Andy Pouch, this is a professor of Carnegie Mellon, and then the Stanford commencement speech from Steve Jobs. Anyway, so that's all I have for you guys. If you have any questions, I'm open for any questions. Okay?
Of neural interfaces looking like? Do you know what that is?
Between the computer and the human, as part mm-hmm. of that. I know what it is, but I have no idea what the future lays on that. I'm sure there is a lot of like health relation and regulatory issues in that, but I have no idea.
Yes?
Hi. You've been at Google for 10 years?
Yes.
14 years?
No, 10 years.
10 years, okay. So that tells me that you know a bit about the culture of the company. So I have just a couple of questions. It's a 3-in-1 question, okay?
Okay.
First is, what does a quality employee at Google possess? The second is, what are the qualities of a contractor or employee who gets an offer for permanent employment at Google? And the third is, besides the obvious factors such as lateness and not following protocol, what is the average length of employment for a contractor or employee who is essentially asked to leave?
All right, let's start with the first one. In terms of quality, I can talk about the position that I'm a software engineer. And I think one of the key things...
Can you hear me? Good. One of the key things that you're going to find that is very common is that, in particular in software, is all highly skilled engineers. We are highly skilled minions. If you've seen the speaker of me, we are all minions, but we're highly skilled. And that is important because what creates is a standard way when you go to a group or to a new team or whatever, you know whoever is in that room is very smart and it knows the stuff they're working with. And there's no magic to it. again, it's a matter of working hard and just doing what you like to do and then focus on getting that done. So sometimes people say, what's the secret to get a hire in Google? And it's just basic computer science stuff. You have to have that, those things, basics. Those basics, right? I literally have people going there and they don't even understand what a hash table is. Basic data structures and algorithms, stuff like that. What was the second question?
It was, what are the qualities of a contractor or employee who gets an offer for permanent employment?
I would say the same, but depending on the, I don't think there's any difference. In particular, I work with a few contractors. There is no difference in terms of my relationship with them or the quality of the work they do. The problem is some of the reasons why they are contractors and not Google employees might be visa-related issues, that it's very difficult to get visas or stuff like that. But it's also common that people that are contractors end up being hired as full-time. So in that term, I haven't seen any particular difference that I can think of right now. And what was the third one?
Besides the obvious, what are the things that someone would do to get asked to leave?
Leaking something, I'm sure.
Well, besides the obvious means someone who doesn't show up for work on time, someone who...
If you think about it, and I think you can read this much, but if you read online, they'll do much, much better job than I'm doing. But Google is more as a university. That's the closest way to think about it. In that sense, I mean, again, in my role as a software engineer, it's very relaxed. The reason why we put a lot of emphasis in hiring is because we want to be able to trust employees a lot. And so that's the key thing. If you know that the people you're hiring are very strong and good, then they'll figure things out. Sometimes you need a little more focus on a particular area or whatever, but in that sense, it's closer to university. Can't comment on that, sorry. Yes. So I don't have any specifics on that in particular. The point is that these are platforms, the same thing that when we announced the SDK for the watch a week ago. So we are just at the very beginning. And these platforms, the reason why we announced them and we put them out there is because we expect also the community to pick up a lot of the work and to just bring some of that innovation too. So I'm sure that a lot of these things are going to happen because the platform, you make it open and allow the community to contribute just for that reason. So things can improve and get way better. I don't have it specific because I don't work on that team, but yeah. Yes?
Can you talk in relation to the paper that you partnered with and with the Google Now stuff you're doing? What percentage of people choose to opt in to the, because this is opt-in, stuff, data that you pull that creates these cards, right?
Mm-hmm.
So is it fairly common that people are opting into giving this information?
I can't comment on specific of numbers right now, but in general, when we started this project, the data collection, we never did that ourselves. The data collection was happening through another product was called Google Latitude. I don't know if you heard of it.
Yes.
And Google Latitude was a product where you share your location with a friend. And so it just so happened that they had enabled this checkbox or this control to allow to store location history in Google servers. And so we were using that data. So we were not doing the data collection, we were doing the data analysis, and then we're building the use cases with that.
Okay, thanks.
Yes.
I remember reading somewhere that someone had analyzed some data and discovered that people
comment. No. Please, in prison now. I work in ads for a year when I joined Google, but I have no visibility into what we're doing on that space.
No, I don't mean like ads specifically,
but
like the data that is being collected through like, you know, users touching stuff.
And yeah, but I mean, that data is highly relevant. I have no visibility into that. Yeah, just to give you a sense, imagine that you're in a company that has, I don't know, 30,000 employees. It's very difficult to know what everybody's doing. So you know a little bit of what you're doing, hopefully. You know you're in deep trouble, but yes, I have no idea on that particular space. Yes?
What are some of the benefits that the employee benefits that you get at Google that most, or other companies don't offer? Because I know Google has very different employee benefits.
I don't know because I've worked in there for 10 years, so I don't know what the other companies are offering right now. But I mean, I think that one of the key things I go back to is to the people, the quality of the people you're going to find. So what was interesting to me, and that's why I said high density great opportunities, the first day I go to Google, and we were all crumpled in Building 42. I don't know if you've ever been to the Google campus. But the Google campus is where, nowadays, the main campus is where Silicon Graphics used to be in Montpellier. And there's this Building 42 where the whole company, when I joined, fit there, and we were literally having desks on the hallways and people are there. And as I'm walking to my hallway, to my desk, I see in the office next to it, two names that caught my attention. One of the guys is Joshua Block, and the other one was Neil Gafter. And Neil Gafter was the guy that was doing the Java compiler in Sun, and Joshua Block is the guy that wrote half of the Java libraries, so if you ever did wrote something in Java, you were using his code. And he wrote a few books. And so they're next to me. And so I look at that and I thought, oh, this is a great opportunity to work with these guys. And literally, I just show up in their office and started talking to them. And then I started working with them, and I worked with Josh for 4 years. We collaborated on a few APIs. And that was a great opportunity because he's one of the best guys I work with. He was kind of my mentor in that sense. And that is a key thing that still happens. You still can find in any area in computer science, and find one of the top guys is probably working at Google at this point. It's a very good place to go and find good mentors in that sense and to have the opportunity to interact with these guys. So I would say that that's probably the best benefit that I get just staying there at this point.
Any other questions? All right, thank you.
Four questions, all right. But this is the last one. Okay. No, no, that's okay. Yeah, it was an interesting startup. When I joined Google Martini, it was roughly 500 people. By the time I left, it was roughly 90 people. So it just, it became a startup again as it was going down. When I joined Google, it was kind of still like a startup because it was roughly 2,000 people still, so it was a large startup, but the feeling was there. There was no hierarchy and we were growing so fast that it was very difficult to keep up. I didn't feel any much difference right there. The other thing, key thing is that even though today we're trying to keep the hierarchy very flat, and that's key, so you literally have managers that have 50, 60 people that report to them, and that's key so that you can keep people in this idea that things are smaller. So I don't think there was such a big contrast, at least when I joined. Anyway, thank you. Have a good day.